person or joining us online, or if you're a visitor, we're very glad that you are worshiping with us today. We'll begin our service as we always do with our gathering song, Welcome Everybody. I invite you to stand as you're able and join in singing and in the hand motions as we sing together. Please rise as you're able. The email goes out to over 300 people each week, so that's a really good way to let people know what is happening with your organization and just in the life of the church in general. So please send those in so that they can then be sent out to the wider community. If you could send email in by noon on Thursday, and then it can be distributed. So there's the email address. If you have questions, you can be sure to ask. As a new school year begins, organizations are back to meeting. So the BB is back starting, I think that'll be this week. So the Anchor Boys are on Fridays from 5:30 to 6:30, the junior section on Thursday from 6:45 to 8:15, and the company section on Friday the 23rd in the evening. So anyone is welcome to join at any time. It's a fun program to be part of. There's more information via email or the Facebook page, so please encourage those who might be interested to come along and join in that. The Gurit Guides are also resuming their meetings again, so that will take place on Thursday at 7:30 in Gurit Primary School. Again, welcome to new members, girls 10 years and older. There's email for more information there, so again, extend the invitation to girls you know, and to the Sunbeams as well. So they also start on Thursday, the 29th of August. This is for girls in P1 and P2. All are welcome Thursday evenings in the Aaron Hall. And they could also use some more adult leaders if you know anyone who could support that group. Flexercise is also resuming classes. That is on Monday mornings at 10:30 in the Aaron Hall. Again, all are welcome. So you can come along for gentle but effective exercise. The summer coffee mornings, you have a couple more opportunities for that. So that's Tuesday morning this week, and I guess next week, from 10 until noon in the hall. It's a great opportunity for fellowship and, of course, tea and home baking. So please come along to that. If you are interested in singing, there's a vocal workshop that is held by the Greenock Philharmonic Choir. It's an open training day, so that's Saturday the 24th of August here in the church. It's an all-day event from 10:30 till 5. You can see the cost, and there will be music provided, so you can find more information there. We'd hope to get a good turnout for that opportunity. The golf event is also taking place next weekend. That's next Sunday. The tee-off slots are between 12:30 and 4:30, and a meal afterwards, so you can be in touch with Alan if you'd like more information or you'd like to attend that. The Dementia Cafe is back up and running on Friday afternoons from 2 until 3:30. If you know anyone who could, who would enjoy that time, please extend the invitation to come along to that. We have quite a few pieces of good news to share today. First off, we're glad as always to welcome Gordon Armour as our guest organist. Thank you for being here. We also have good news from the Dementia Cafe, which is that to celebrate its second birthday, the Dementia Cafe enjoyed a tea dance and afternoon tea on Friday. So a big thank you to the dedicated volunteers for providing and serving a lovely afternoon tea, which was enjoyed by all. And a special thank you to Shirley and Sandy McGugan for leading the dancing with style and grace. So it was much appreciated by everyone, and we celebrate the second birthday of the Dementia Cafe. I think there might be a photograph to share of Sunday school sunflowers to see their growth. Somewhere, there they are. So Darcy, Katie, Sophie, and Susie, do you remember planting those sunflowers? Can you believe how tall they are? That's amazing. So hopefully you can all head out to see the progress in real life, but that is a really fun thing that our Sunday school children have gotten to see grow, and for all of us as well. Other good news from Joan is that Callum got very good news at the hospital on Wednesday. So I know lots of us have been praying for that. So Joan and the family would like to thank everyone for their kind and thoughtful words and their prayers. They were very much appreciated. So that's wonderful news that we celebrate with you, and of course continue our prayers for continued good news. Is there other good news to share this morning? We had a nice outdoor service last Sunday. That was really good. And a somewhat sunny Sunday again today. And as always, it is good to worship with you all. So again, if you have future intimations, please share those via email by noon on Thursday so they can be sent out. And good news, you can leave a note when you come to church on Sunday mornings. I think that's it. So we'll continue in our worship. We'll sing our first hymn, number 159, Lord, for the Years. Again, please rise as you're able and join as we sing together.
Lord, for the years, through the love has kept and guided.
some children over here. How are we all today?
Good.
Did any of you bring anything with you to church today? Did we bring our backpacks to church? Ooh, stand over here. Awesome. Because why? Did any of you go back to school or nursery this week? Some of us started school, started nursery. Yeah, and how are we feeling about it? Thumbs up? Thumbs up? Any thumbs down? Two thumbs up. I love that. That's really good. So we can feel a lot of things when we start something new. So what are some of the feelings that you're feeling? Is anybody happy to go back to school? Yeah, big hands up. Again, two thumbs up, love it. Was anybody a little bit nervous? Yeah. Sometimes the parents are a little bit nervous for sure. Were any of you tired at the end of the day? No, you were energized. Yeah, again, parents are a little bit tired by the end of the day. And all of those feelings that we feel are okay. And you know, we talk a lot about how God is always with us no matter where we go and no matter what we feel. And so as you start a new year at school, we wanted to give all of you this special tag. And you can put it on your backpack if you want. I was wondering, can anyone read that for me? What does that say? It says, be loved, be kind, be you. So I was thinking, if you put this on your backpack or maybe on your lunchbox or even just by your bed or something, whenever you see it, you'll be reminded that God is always with you. And you'll be reminded that you are so loved, right? God loves you. Your family loves you. Your friends love you. Everybody here loves you. And that feels good to know how loved we are, right? Yeah, double thumbs up for that, I'd say. It can remind you to be kind. So we're kind to old friends and to new friends, to our teachers and to everyone we meet, right? Jesus was very kind and we are called to be like Jesus. And then it also says, be you. So God made you and you are so special just as you are. And there's only one person like you. And so we need you to be exactly who you are, right? Because you're really special and awesome. So we have tags for each of you. We can hand out there. And then we also have tags for any grown-ups, any teachers who are going back to school, any parents or grandparents, if you want to take your tags and give them to the students in your life, we've got plenty so you can take after the service. But you can find a special place to put those tags to be reminded that God is always with you. Yep. Again, teachers need them as well. Yep. So, all right, thank you so much. And then normally we say a prayer at the end of this time together, but today I'm going to say a blessing for you. So a blessing is I'll say words and that you can receive them and keep these words in your heart. So this school year, may you be curious and kind, gentle and strong, brave and loving. And may you remember that God is always with you as you sit and as you stand, as you learn and as you play, in every fear and every celebration, may you know that God, your friend, is always there. So that is your blessing as you start a new school year, and we'll be excited to hear about all the things that you get to learn and do at school. So thank you so much. And again, we've got more backpack tags for anybody who wants to take some with them after the service. So we'll sing our next hymn together. It is Our God is a God Who Makes Friends, a good message for the start of the school year. And kids are going to head out to Young Church, so that'll be fun. All right, please rise as you're able, and we'll sing together.
Our God is a God who makes friends.
friends. Our first reading today comes from the Old Testament. We're reading from the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 6, verses 20 through 25. Oh, again, some of us are tired after getting back to nursery and such. But Eleanor has our reading today. Thank you.
In the future, when your son asks you, "What is the meaning of the stipulations, decrees, and laws the Lord our God has commanded you?" tell him, "We were slaves of Pharaoh in Egypt, but the Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand. Before our eyes, the Lord sent miraculous signs and wonders, great and terrible, upon Egypt and Pharaoh and his whole household. But he brought us out from there to bring us in and give us the land that he promised on oath to our forefathers. The Lord commanded us to obey all these decrees and to fear the Lord our God, so that we might always prosper and be kept alive, as is the case today. And if we are careful to obey all this law before the Lord our God, as he has commanded us, that will be our righteousness. Amen."
Well, now let us join our hearts in prayer, and we'll say the Lord's Prayer together at the end. Let us pray. Holy God, together we gather in your name, here in this place and online, in every age and every stage of life and faith, from all the places we have been, anticipating all the places you will call us to go. Together we worship you, offering our prayers, our time, our resources, our voices in song, our whole selves, giving you thanks for the good news of the gospel story and for all of the good things in our lives. Together we also confess and ask for your forgiveness, trusting in your unending mercy and acknowledging the ways we have fallen short, the ways we have turned away from you and from our neighbors. Together we ask for your guidance, that in your grace you would lead us back to your path and continue to teach us and show us how to live as many times as we need to learn. Together we listen again to the stories of our faith, of how you loved and continue to love your children and all of your creation. Inspire us by your word, O God, that we would be equipped to share your love with everyone we meet, to follow the example of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us how to pray, saying together, "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen." And now we'll have our second reading from the New Testament. We're in John's Gospel, chapter 9, verses 13 through 25. Thanks again, Eleanor.
The Pharisees investigate the healing. They brought to the Pharisees the man who had been blind. Now the day on which Jesus had made the mud and opened the man's eyes was a Sabbath. Therefore the Pharisees also asked him how he had received his sight. "He put mud on my eyes," the man replied, "and I washed, and now I see." Some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, for he does not keep the Sabbath." But others asked, "How can a sinner do such miraculous signs?" So they were divided. Finally, they turned again to the blind man. "What have you to say about him? It was your eyes he opened." The man replied, "He is a prophet." The Jews still did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they sent for the man's parents. "Is this your son?" they asked. "Is this the one you say was born blind? How is it that now he can see? We know he is our son, the parents answered, and we know he was born blind. But how he can see now, or who opened his eyes, we don't know. Ask him. He is of age, he will speak for himself. His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews, for already the Jews had decided that anyone who acknowledged that Jesus was the Christ would be put out of the synagogue. That was why his parents said, "He is of age, ask him." A second time they summoned the man who had been blind. "Give glory to God," they said. "We know this man is a sinner." He replied, "Whether he is a sinner or not, I don't know. One thing I do know, I was blind, but now I see." Amen, and thanks be to God for these readings from his holy word, and to his name be all the praise and the glory.
Thank you, Eleanor. We'll sing together again our next hymn, number 561, Blessed Assurance. Please rise as you're able. That every year in the spring, when high school seniors were getting ready to graduate, the board was used to share their names and the universities they were planning to attend, and that seemed like a really nice idea to celebrate them. But before I arrived, that tradition was stopped. It turned out that the bulletin board, making public and prominent the achievements and future plans of these young people, caused way too much stress and anxiety. Some youth found themselves unable to walk down that hallway or even look at that bulletin board because they were reminded of the schools that maybe they didn't get accepted to or They felt that their accomplishments weren't quite as notable when compared to those of their peers. There was this idea, this story that had been told and believed and ingrained in the youth that their whole future was determined by their university acceptances or rejections. That the entire trajectory of their life was permanently set at age 17 or 18. That their identity was in their grades and their worth was measured by their exam results. And I can remember that feeling. I remember buying into that narrative, and I was reminded of it again in recent days as students here received their exam results. It's such a stressful time. It's such an immense amount of pressure. And maybe you're going through it just now, or you too can remember that period of your life. Maybe you're getting to experience it again with children or grandchildren this time around. The thing is, once you're past it, you can see the bigger picture. You can recognize that a handful of exam results are not the be-all and end-all, and that there are so many opportunities ahead. But it's really tough to have that perspective when you're in the middle of it, and when the dominant story being told is that you have to get certain results and take certain paths in order to be successful. The stories that we tell and hear and believe and carry with us matter. And stories are more than just facts or evidence. They are the narratives that we tell about those facts, the way we interpret what is before us. Stories are how we make sense of what happens to us and around us. They are the framework in which we navigate the world and relationships with others. They are what we pass down from generation to generation in life and in faith. And so we're going to be thinking about stories as we explore our two readings today. Our first passage from the Old Testament or the Hebrew Bible is part of the story that our Jewish neighbors tell on Passover, part of what's known as the Haggadah. Throughout the book of Deuteronomy, where our reading is from, we find Moses trying to impart to the people the importance of remembering what God had done, because that determined how they were to live. Just a few verses before our passage picks up, we find what is known as the Shema, which reads, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone." That's a foundational confession of faith in Judaism. Those few words relay who God is, and what follows sets forth the relationship between God and Israel and all that it entails. And this relationship requires that God's people follow God's laws, that they obey God's statutes and ordinances. And so our reading looks forward to a time when a young person might ask an elder in the midst why things are the way they are. What is the meaning of all of it? Why obey all these rules and laws? What is this story about? Well, the response is that the Lord our God is Lord and has commanded it. God has done all these things, has brought the people out of Israel, has brought them into the promised land, has kept the promises made to their ancestors. God is faithful and loving, and we must remember that. And not only must we remember, we then have to live accordingly. One writer explained that these words from Deuteronomy are to be kept in communal conscience, to be passed on to the children, and they should be everywhere constantly. The story of what God has done has to be carried in the hearts of the people and through the generations, for it is the defining story on which everything else is built. And this story would have been known to Jesus and his first followers, as they themselves were all Jewish. They would have known the law, too, that the Sabbath was a holy day on which it was forbidden to do any work. So the fact that in our second reading, Jesus healed a man who had been born blind on the Sabbath obviously caused some controversy. Jesus encountered this man as he walked along with his disciples, And the man didn't ask to be healed, but still Jesus restored his sight so that God's works might be revealed in him. But first, the man's neighbors and then the religious leaders had questions about this miraculous healing. Is this really the man they knew who was born blind? How did this happen? Who did it? And on the Sabbath, no less. When asked, the man told the truth as he knew it. He told the story of what happened to him. Jesus put mud on his eyes and told him to go wash in the pool, which he did, and then he was able to see. He was changed after his encounter with Jesus physically, but also spiritually, as he came to understand Jesus as a prophet who could do incredible works. But his story didn't satisfy his neighbors or the religious authorities because it didn't fit in the framework through which they understood the world. Such a miracle being done by a man who dared to break the law just did not line up with the narrative that they held to in terms of faith and sin and righteousness. And how often it is that we reject stories that we don't understand, that don't fit with the narrative that has shaped our life so far. It's not easy or fun to examine the stories we have come to believe, to have to rewrite parts or all of them if necessary. The stories we build our lives around and carry with us matter. They matter for how we think and act and speak and treat others and ourselves. So the stories of our faith, the ones we read in Scripture, the ones that are passed down from generation to generation, the ones that tell us about what God has done, what God is doing, and what God will continue to do, they matter because they reveal to us what we are therefore called to do and how we are called to live. And there will always be different stories competing to take root in our hearts, messages that we are not good or worthy enough to be loved, a narrative that kindness need only be reserved for those who look like us or think like us or act like us, a story that tells us we need to be a certain way or change certain things about ourselves in order to fit in. But the backpack tags that we handed out to the children today say, be loved, be kind, be you. And that message tells the story of who God is and who we are because of that. It's a message I hope that the children carry with them always, but especially as they embark on a new school year that is hopefully fun and exciting, although might also bring some nerves and challenges. I hope it reminds them that they are not alone and that they are loved by a God who has shown us what it looks like to offer love and kindness to others and who journeys with us as we live out the story of our lives. So the message for the children today is the message for all of us. Be loved, be kind, be you. That is the story we are called to embody, a story that we get to pass on, a story that has the power to shape our faith and our lives and our world. And thanks be to God for that story. Our next hymn comes from the new supplementary hymnal, so the words might be unfamiliar, but I believe the tune is known. So again, I invite you to rise as you're able as we sing together.
Thank you.
time of prayer where we lift up all of our joys and concerns to God, giving thanks for all that brings joy and naming all that brings sorrow too. And in our lives and in the wider world, there are so many things that we can name, really too many, but we trust that God knows all the prayers of our hearts, even the ones we haven't yet found words for. So as we go to God in prayer, we'll begin with a moment of quiet to remember those people and situations closest to us. Let us pray. Holy God, we give thanks for this world that you created and called good, for all that lives upon it, all the resources the planet provides, and all the beauty that surrounds us. But we confess that we have not cared for the earth as you call us to do, and so the devastating effects are felt everywhere and by everyone, but especially those who are most vulnerable. Guide us to be the stewards we need to be so that this and future generations would enjoy the beauty of the earth and have access to plentiful and clean water, air, and soil. O Lord, we pray for all the places where there is conflict of any kind, the places on the news each night, and the places that never make the front page, where war and violence disrupt the everyday lives of your people and tear apart communities. We long for your peace to be known in every corner of the globe, and we give thanks for those who work to make it so, even as we pray for those with the most power, for leaders of all nations, to act in good faith to bring an end to violence in all its forms. So too, we pray for your justice to be known in every community, for all of your children to have safe places to live and work, to go to school and play, to have enough food to eat and the resources needed to live lives of dignity. Again, we give thanks for those who seek justice, and we pray that we would all participate in that holy work in the spaces where we find ourselves. We pray for all who are suffering, those who are known to us and those who are known only to you, for any who are struggling with grief or illness or addiction or mental health. We pray for your presence and love to be known, and that we would be able to comfort those we meet in the ways we are able, offering love and hope and kindness in our words and our actions. We pray for your church, O God, here and wherever your people gather in your name. Unite us and equip us to go out and serve, working alongside all who share a vision for a better and more just world. We give thanks for the stories of our faith, passed down from generation to generation, for the truth in knowing that we are loved by you and called to love our neighbors. We give thanks for the stories of our lives that are still being written, and that you are journeying with us every step of the way. And especially today, we pray for all who have started and who will start a new school year, for the youngest among us at nursery and those who are beginning their first year of primary school, to teachers and school staff with decades of experience behind them, and everyone in between. We pray that this year offers opportunities to learn and grow, to be challenged and inspired, to make new friends and make a difference in the world around them. For that is your call for each and every one of us, and we give thanks that you are with us as we seek to live it out, following in the example of your Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name we offer all of our prayers. Amen. We'll sing our final hymn before the benediction, and then our sung blessing, and then, of course, you're all invited to join for tea and coffee in the hall. But now, please rise as you're able as we sing together hymn number 526, This is a Day of New Beginnings.
Thank you.
do, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and always. God of peace go with us.